They are also not part of it, and I am not in any way associated with them, because essentially I have no body, and therefore I have no sense instruments also, instruments of the various senses. Now, the point to be made here is that generally, when somebody says that I am the Atman, it obviously means that all these instruments, or what are called as upadhis or upakaranas, or the various bodies which have the organs of action and organs of perception, they are only to be considered as a kind of accretion which are there along with the bodies. The fact of the matter is, we will be able to intellectually appreciate this factor only intellectually and very partially, and as a kind of a hypothesis that is suggested, to us. In the sense, deep down within oneself, one does not feel so strongly and intuitively that one is not the body. For reading and listening and things like that, it may appear to be fine. Yeah, sir, we are not the body. We are not this body, set of bodies, or the various koshas, or the organs of senses, or organs of action, or whatever it is. Because we have gone through a narrative, and a narration has been given as to what is the Atman and how it is not connected with any of these things. All that description may give us a kind of complacent acceptance of the suggestions that are made only from a superficial point of view. I hope you are able to understand. Only we are able to only superficially say that I am not this body and I am not these senses. Is it really true? The point, yeah, there is some disturbance, sir. Some new entrants are there, and kindly, the School of Ancient Wisdom, may I request the host also to mute yourself. Ravi, if you are there, thank you. And if it's not very inconvenient, you can make me the host so that I need not disturb you every time. Okay, fine. Now
I'm here, sir. No problem.
Yeah, okay. If you are here, if you are there, it's okay. No, I don't want to disturb you. Okay. So the point is that deep down in the core of our being, do we really sense the fact that I am not the body? That's what I'm trying to say. One has to answer this for oneself. I am not the body. The body is only an instrument. The body is only something which has been acquired for a limited purpose, or to go by the observation in the Bhagavad Gita, that the body is like a vestment, is like our attire, like our dress, which we wear and remove it, and which we throw away when it is no longer useful, when it is when it is when its condition has deteriorated. Now this has to be in some way a great reality to us and not a mere mental construct. That is the fundamental point. And that is where the intuitive appreciation of Atma Bodha comes. Please mind this very carefully. Let us, it's all a great lesson for all of us. It is not some kind of self-hypnosis and saying to oneself that I am not this body, I am not this body, I am not this body. No. One should be able to very clearly discriminate between what one really is and what all these bodies are. In the sense that the body should not overpower us and dominate our actions and thoughts and feelings and so on. That is the essential factor. Left to itself, the body would always like to be in a very comfortable position and not to be disturbed too much and not to be troubled too much also. Left to itself, that will be the nature, because it is of the nature of gross matter and inertia. Inertia in the sense, it is by its very construction, by its very, you know, structural formation, it is tamasic by nature. It is tamasic by nature. Some of us may not really be that way. Some of us may be very active and feel that rajasic element in us. But the predominance is of rajasic and tamasic natures. And if you see, the tamasic nature is more also sometimes. The body has a consciousness of itself, of its own, as an independent way of functioning and trying to manipulate itself into a very comfortable zone. Especially when it encounters some situations which are not to its liking. Some things of which are of its liking, it may act in that manner. For example, it would like to eat. Okay, Dayanand Maneji, would you please mute yourself?
Yes, sir.
Kindly. There's some disturbance in the background. Okay, thank you. So we have to realize the nature of the body. We have to make it very sensitive. We have to make it very sensitive. And at the same time, I think it's getting unmuted. Dayananji, it's every time it's getting unmuted. Yeah, thank you. I think there is some, kindly monitor that and see that it is not unmuted. So the point I'm trying to make is this body has to be made very sensitive, number one, and also to be treated only as an instrument and as a body, and not allow it to dominate all our actions. Because left to itself, it will do that. That is the reason why some of the texts mention that the body should be treated like a very, you know, fine horse. You should maintain it like you maintain a race horse or a horse which is used in the battlefield, on the battlefield. That means you need to give it proper food, proper rest, proper exercise, and all that. And it is meant for a very special and specific purpose, which is very limited, and not indulge in things which are going to be harmful to it. And the biggest problem is food and rest. These two are the most important things for the body, and it tries to manipulate itself into a position where it will always seek pleasure. So one should be able to communicate with the body as a separate instrument and make it understand that it is meant for a different purpose altogether. This is what is all sadhana about. This is what is all sadhana is about. Initially, when we are talking about yama, niyama, and other things from the yoga philosophy point of view and from the Vedanta point of view also, it is this communication and sensitization of the body to operate in a manner in which the indweller wants. Like, as the example that is normally given is that the tail should not wag the dog. The dog should be able to wag the tail and have the tail under its control, and not the other way around. Because this is a very small and a limited part of the whole structure, all whole constitution of man. So, a deep affirmation and a deep sense of realization that I am not this body. Even if it undergoes pain and decay and suffering, or what we call as some kind of afflictions, it should still be able to understand that it is only the body. It is only the body. Unless we come to this affirmation and that deep realization, it will always try to dominate us, dominate all our activities. This is where all kinds of discipline come about. You have to do something on at a particular time, you have to do it. You have to feed it at a particular moment and also know the limitation of feeding it. How much to consume, what to consume, what not to consume. How much to rest and how much to be wakeful and active. All these things are required. See, Jiddu Krishnamurti used to negate all these scriptural, what I would call as discourses and the great knowledge that is disseminated through the scriptures. He would negate all of that because of this reason, that if you do not consider those things seriously and make it as a part of your whole being and realize the truth of it, it is of no consequence at all. Whether the Gita says or some other holy scripture says or some great saint or sage or somebody says, is totally immaterial when it is not really true for you. Jiddu Krishnamurti usually used to say that if you are sensitive, how can you overfeed the body? And similarly, he would always say that he used to have a communication with the body, and many people in the normal course of things may not know, but he would almost spend two and a half hours in doing yoga and yogasanas and pranayama. But it was not an obsession for him at any time. It seems he would get up in the morning sometimes and ask the body, shall we do yoga today? Then if the body said yes, he would go ahead with it. And he himself would say, sometimes the body would say, no, I am not willing to do yogasanas now, because yesterday you went for a meeting at long distance and you spent 2 hours talking to them, and then you had to travel a long distance to come back, and therefore I am tired. I would like to take rest today, or I would like a few more hours of rest. That's how the body used to communicate to him. Now, we cannot act like him. Because if I start asking my body, shall we do yogasanas and pranayama, every damn day, every morning, it would say no only. And it will justify in so many ways. Yesterday you went there, you came here, you did something else and something else. So that deception is very much possible if you do not have the discipline. Or if you do not have that highly sensitive body, which has a link, which has a, as I said, a means of communicating with it. And very aptly, very, very rightly, several times he used to say, if you are sensitive, how can you overeat? But the fact of the matter is, a fellow like me is not sensitive and he is prone to overeating. And that was the reason why, if you see his structure, it never changed in about 50, 60 years. He never put on a pound of extra weight here or there and become obese or he never appeared that way, because it seems 90s his dresses and suits, especially these western attires, so suits and all, which he was using in the 1940s, he would use them in the 80s also. That is what is to be understood from this shloka, that I am other than the body and I am not subject to changes. I, in the sense, the atmic principle, the principle of Atman operating, says that I am other than this body and I am not subject to these modifications of birth, old age, decay and death. Similarly, because I am not the body, I am also not the instruments which are functioning through the body, and therefore I am in no way associated with the objects of the senses. The objects of the senses. That is the meaning of it. So this can come about only one has that sensitive approach to it, and also open a channel of communication with these instruments. And when we go further, it will say the same thing to the mind also, that I am not the mind. So that it doesn't drag you away towards the objects of the senses. Because the senses operate under the control of the mind. So this is what is important from our point of view. So initially, it may require that we may have to affirm and reaffirm and continue to intuitively realize that I am not the body, and simultaneously make it more sensitive by opening a channel of communication. By opening a channel of communication, you can communicate with the body. As you communicate sometimes to a pet dog or a pet animal. Because this body has definitely several of the animalistic tendencies. And from the theosophical perspective, it is mentioned that each body has a low level of independent conscious entity called as an elemental controlling it. that elemental will always object to anything which is against its normal tendency of gross inertia. If you don't feed it properly, it will shout, it will start howling and yelling and crying and saying that today I didn't get enough food, and as much as I wanted of that particular dish, which is very tasty. And it is also, this elemental is a useful thing actually. This is a low level consciousness, conscious entity is a useful thing, because most of the time instinctively it is protect us from danger and other things also. Because it can sense danger before the mind can sense the danger. So there are some useful principles, but at the same time its natural direction is downwards. It would prefer to lie down in a very comfortable position. It would prefer to be fed with food of its liking and in adequate or substantial quantities also. That is the reason why the Bhagavad Gita says yukta ahara viharasya. It should have only limited and sufficient food and exercise, and other things should be given. An integrated approach to the body also is required, because it should be fed on good food, given enough rest, but not overfeed it or over rest it, and give it proper exercise, and generally maintain good health, so that it is at the beck and call of the indweller, the indwelling atmic principle that is operating, the consciousness that is operating, whose natural direction is upwards. So always there appears to be some kind of a tug of war going on, that the higher principle is trying to pull it upwards and the lower principle is pulling downwards. And most of the time it is the lower principle which will win, because it is more powerful and it is downward directed. It's always difficult to go up, to climb a mountain or climb stairs or something is difficult. But to come down, it is easier. So it has the body and the lower principle has a dual advantage of being downward in direction and more energetic than the upward force, because we have not yet realized the nature of the upward pulling entity, which we are calling as the atmic principle. So this is the essential aspect that is being brought out in this verse. It should not be taken only superficially, saying that I am not the body and I am free from all these things, and I am not the senses or the instruments of the senses, they don't operate through me, and therefore if you can compare with the earlier principles which he talked about what the Atman is and how the Atman is to be understood. Here, in a different context, the same principle is being brought to focus through the other side of it. Earlier, it was the higher side. Now, from the lower side, it's also pointing out that I am not the body, I am not the senses, and I am not subject to any of these changes. This is what is important. So, as I mentioned right at the beginning, two things have to happen. And one set of it is a constant affirmation and coming to terms with the reality, with the fact of the matter that I am not the body. At the same time, you make it sensitive and open a channel of communication with it. These are the two things. Hope I am clear. One, as I said, somewhere deep down in the core of our being, one should be able to affirm and realize that I am not the body. The body is an instrument given to me. The body is what I have acquired in the process of evolution, and it is meant for a very sacred purpose. And because it is for a very sacred purpose, one has to make it sensitive. Deho devalaya proktaha. The deha is called as a devalaya. The body is called as a temple. The indwelling Atman is the deity in the temple. Deho devalaya proktaha jivo devasanatana. The jiva inside, the atmic principle operating is the deva or the idol or the in the sanctum sanctorum, which is sanatana, which is eternal. This realization has to come in, and it will, these two things go together. The affirmation and realization will go together with making it more and more sensitive, and also to what I have mentioned as knowing its true purpose. Make it more sensitive and fit for a higher purpose. Open a channel of communication. So these things go simultaneously. It's not that one starts with this and goes step by step. It's an, in a very integral manner, if you look at it, all these things could happen simultaneously. That is the essential aspect of what here it is mentioned as, that the Atman is something different from the body, and also it is something which does not have any senses associated with it, and therefore it has no link or connection or association with the objects of the senses. That is the fundamental aspect of it. Then he goes to the next principle. Similarly, the deha is over. He says, yeah.
There are a couple of questions I had on this.
Okay.
So it seems like the body has a mind of its own, but you explained it very nicely when you said that there's something called the elemental.
Yeah.
Which is a lower level of consciousness and which is more animal-like in its tendencies. But the question I had for you was two questions. One is that, so animals, after they are fed, they lie down and there's a natural tamasic tendency.
Right. So
if we don't control our minds and strengthen our will, we will always be led by these baser principles. Is that right?
Yes. See, you will get the body you deserve. The karmic principle also operates on the same things as you mentioned. Our vasanas and samskaras and karma will also determine the nature of your body. You get in this in a particular life.
Yes. So you answered that also. Okay.
So, but you cannot absolve yourself of your responsibility and saying, see, all my family is obese. I come from a family who are all fat and obese and have this kind of thing. And therefore, you can't absolve yourself. That has been your nature. And in order to, you know, undergo certain karma, you are given a certain body with certain weaknesses and strengths and things like that.
Okay.
So the fundamental aspect is to take responsibility for oneself. That is important. Okay. Vijayalakshmi ji says, then why do we make such a fuss about the last rites, etc., which is for the body? You need not make much fuss. See, that truly speaking, if one were to lead a good life, his body is of no consequence at all. Generally, it is said of great saints and sages that along with their physical body, their astro-mental body also dies simultaneously. That means there are no residual desires and strong thoughts and other things associated with them. They can exhaust them while they are still in the body, and they can simply dispose of the entire set of bodies, the lower bodies, at the time of death. See, what happens is, because that does not happen in most of the cases, that means what I am telling you could be one in a million case. But what about the rest of them? The rest of them need some kind of a support system. So the rites and rituals are support systems which provide us with some kind of a comfort level to transit from one level of consciousness to another level of consciousness, which we find it very difficult. That's what they have described in all after-death experiences and all. See, the transition is the problem. And all the Vedic rituals help in this transition. If you understand the mantras correctly, it says tapopashamana. The tapa, the heat that is produced on account of this transition through death and through the process of cremation, the upashamana has to be performed. A propitiatory ritual has to be performed, where the transition for that particular individual, for that jiva, is smooth. That is the reason. But if you are, see, some great people have simply said, don't do anything with this body. As I said, Jiddu Krishnamurti said, you know that I have always been maintaining a very clean body. So after my death, simply clean it properly, cover it with a good white cloth, wrap it up, and burn it away. That's all. Don't do anything. No rituals, nothing. So nothing is required. Is it simply like any other log of wood? You please cremate it, burn it to ashes. That's all. It is out of their own respect that some of his close associates and all brought some ashes from there to India and took it to England and some other places. But that's only, that's of no consequence at all. Truly speaking, if one can live a life during which period he is able to drop off all desires and thoughts with which such desires are associated, technically speaking, he is already liberated. Such a person is called in the scriptures as a Jivan Mukta. That means he has attained liberation or that freedom while he is still alive and operating through a body. For such a person, no ritual is required. And for a person who is grossly engrossed or grossly involved in all these things, for him also the rituals will only make marginal difference. They can't really make great difference. They will only make a marginal difference. That's all. So Vijayalakshmi, you are right in one way. You need not make much fuss about it and do it. But while we are alive, take care of it. See that it is healthy. See that it helps you to function normally. Of course, your karmic links and all, which may create some afflictions, some disease and other things, you just go with it. Okay? Is that clear, Vijayalakshmi ji?
Yes, sir.
Any other doubt?
No, thank you. But I just felt that it was, you know, this commercialization of organized religion and, you know, all these priests and all that have really, there is terrorizes so much, blackmail us so much, saying that your Pitradevatas will curse you and this and that. I mean, maybe that's a topic for another day, but I just wanted to tell you there's so much emphasis on the material part of it, you know.
No, no, see,
because it keeps scaring us with this Garuda Purana and all that. People like us, it's
who can be who is the one who can be manipulated like that, who is ignorant, isn't it?
Yeah, I suppose so.
See, when you are performing a Pitru Yajna, the Vedic ritual says correctly that you have to do your Pitru Karma or whatever is called as Pitrukarya has to be done, but that's not that is out of great devotion and reverence. It has to be done with lot of Shraddha. Only when you do it with lot of Shraddha, then it becomes a Shraddha. See, the Pitrukarma is called as a Shraddha. Shraddha means one that which is done with lot of Shraddha. That means you hold your forefathers in great reverence and you look up to them for your moral strength and also for having brought you into this life and given you a good life and all that. Therefore, you show your reverence to them by performing the Pitrukarya. But don't be scared of any of these things. See, the people will scare you because we are ignorant. We do not know the meaning of the mantras. See, in my case, several times what happens is, many of these priests who are not well versed in the mantras are afraid of coming to my home for performing this Pitru Yajna, Pitrukarya. Because I will stop them there, ask them the meaning of the mantra and do they really understand it or if they are uttering properly or not has to be checked, provided you know it. We don't know and they keep saying whatever they like and they'll scare you and say so many things. So don't go by this Garuda Purana and other these things are performing rituals without understanding. Most of the rituals, why most of the rituals? All the rituals are supposed to be performed by oneself. Because I am not capable of doing it, I will ask the support of somebody. Okay? So there is nothing to be scared of. Each one will get the whatever is his karma, he will undergo that karma and has to come out of it on his own. But yes, some if the children and the friends and the relations of the person who has died are truly good people and who have a very good association with him, the good thoughts of such persons can really help in the other world to cross over peacefully and acclimatize himself or herself to that new environment. That's all.
Yes, sir. Thank you, sir.
Binaji said that is what animals do after being fed. They lie down. So there is a natural thought. If we don't have control over our mind, we'll be able to. Yeah, that's what happens. That's how it operates. This is where one has to come to terms with things and then develop one's own will and then be able to say firmly, have a control of it. Control in the sense, control through understanding. Not out of fear or not out of compulsion or not out of some, vague or nebulous idea in one's mind that one needs to control and all that. That is the fundamental principle. Okay? Then we'll go to the third. Yes, sir.
Yes, that actually explains why knowledge is very important. Because that knowledge, with knowledge, we are not fearful then. Because then we know.
Yes.
Yeah, yeah.
And you will be operating with that knowledge.
Right. Thank you.
Then he goes to from the body, he goes to the mind and says, Amanastvan name dukkha raga dvesha bhayadayah aprano hyamanaha shubhraha ityadi shruti shasanat. He says, I am other than the mind and hence I am free from sorrow, attachment, malice and fear. For he is without breath and without mind, pure and so on. Is the commandment of the great scriptures, the Upanishads. Aprano Hyamanaha Shubhraha is a drawn from the Upanishadic statement. And therefore, he says the Upanishads very clearly say that you are not the prana, you are not the manas, and you are pure. And because you are not the mind, sorrow or attachment or hatred, fear, and all these things are not something connected with you. When he says you or me, he is referring to the atmic principle operating in us. So we are not the body. Can you just hold on for a minute? Hello? Yeah, can I call you after half an hour? I'm in a webinar. So you see, you are not the body, you are not the mind, and you are not the different pranas which are operating through you, and you are ever pure because nothing impure can touch that atmic principle. And therefore, essentially, one is really free of attachment and hatred, fear and sorrow. These things are also like things happening on the surface, like the waves of an ocean. There's another very traditional comparison that is made, that all these things are like the waves of an ocean, which are always there only on the surface, but deep down, it is totally calm and peaceful, and nothing can disturb that state of peace and calm. So here again, the same idea is repeated from the point of view of the mind also. So see, again, the important point of it is, whenever we encounter pain or suffering or sorrow, if we examine ourselves in that state, we are totally and completely involved in it. At that point of time, we are suffering. We are, it's not that I am suffering something. It is the very suffering is me. So close is the attachment, so close is the activity of the mind with us, that it will refuse to detach itself and look at it as an instrument separate from the true me, the true Atman that is operating in me. That is the extent of the hold of this suffering or sorrow, which makes us completely involved in it, when the fact of the matter is that it is not so. Truly, attachment or detachment or hatred or envy or fear or anger and sorrow cannot touch the Atman at all, the true principle operating, because it is not recognized, because the Atmic principle operating in us is not recognized by us. And because we ourselves feel that we are the body and the mind, or the body-mind complex, as it is said, obviously it will get totally involved in it and unable to free itself from this entanglement. Here again, the same principle comes of a deep affirmation and a realization at the core of our being that I am not the mind. The mind is only an instrument. And the instrument cannot be the me. Instrument is only the instrument. So from the true identity point of view, this is only something external to me, which is temporarily attached to me. That has to be realized. Otherwise, what happens is every time we get entangled here and then feel very strong forces acting through us, strong attachments, strong detachments, strong sense of fear or sorrow, strong sense of fear. Why does it overcome us? It overcomes us because we are totally involved in it. A strong sense of, it is inevitable at a certain level, but how fast can you detach yourself from that is important. It's not that somebody is asking to become like a stoic, or somebody is asking you to become insensitive to these things and something which you should refuse to undergo. No, nobody is asking for that kind of thing. Having got into that state, how fast or how soon can you get out of it and realize that I am not the mind which is undergoing this suffering? I am not the mind which is creating these attachments or hatreds and the fear component of it. See, fear and imitation are the two great elements which help us to build our own mind. Deep-seated fear is there because of uncertainty, because of seeking of security, protecting itself. That has been the process of evolution. So there is a deep-seated fear in us, which is a mental faculty or mental aspect of it. And similarly, the mind learns through a process of imitation. Right from childhood, we have learned several things by imitating our parents, our siblings, our neighbors, our friends, and our contacts. See, we learn through that process. This is where one needs to question it. How can this process be me? How can this process of acquisition that has been going on, can it really be called as the me? Why is it that I have created this false identity and continue to hold on to it? That is where the deep sense of realization has to come. I am not the mind. In no way am I the mind. Even if there is a temporary aberration in me of fear or anger or jealousy or envy or hatred or love or whatever you call, I should be able to disentangle myself and then say, no, it's only something temporary which has been going on. And as I mentioned, the sooner and the faster you are able to emerge out of it every time you are into it, the better will be your understanding of the fact that the body and the mind are something external to the true identity which I am, which I actually am. Otherwise, it'll get caught in it. Otherwise, it will get caught in it and it will strengthen it. Every attachment, every desire, every hatred, every fear, every complex will get strongly attached to this false identity and then make it undergoes, you know, lives and lives of suffering. We can do some small analysis. I keep telling my, you know, close friends and even my son, when I'm talking to him, I keep telling him one thing. See, don't develop strong attachments and strong sense of hatred towards somebody. You have somebody has said something which I carry now in my mind for years together, for decades together. Is it worthwhile? It's only depleting my energy, number one. Number two is, look at it from a broader perspective. The person who has actually abused you or said something against you, said something which you did not like and all that, your total contact with such a person, if you can measure, would be in a few, you can count it and see it was only a few hours or few days at the most. But this false identity makes you suffer for decades. Is it worthwhile? Some relation, some contact, some so-called, you know, part of the larger family with whom we come into contact very rarely. Maybe in some wedding or some function or somewhere else or something. Our whole contact throughout our life may be 10, 20, 30, 40 hours. But should we carry a deep sense of anger and hatred and these negative factors in our mind, which will rankle for decades and decades, and that's where we get depleted of all energy, and therefore we don't have energy for our pursuit of any spiritual progress at all? That is what is important. That's why he says, amanastvatvan name dukkha ragadvesha bhayadayah. Because I'm not the mind, I'm also not suffering and sorrow and attachment and detachment or hatred and fear and so on. They're also external. When the mind itself is external to me, the things that are going on in the mind are much more external because they are only temporary. in that sense, one needs to very carefully analyze and drop them. You have to simply drop them. If they are not a part of you, don't carry that burden at all. Never carry that burden at all. Because we have better things to do. We have better things to achieve, better things to look forward for. But if you are entangled in all these silly things, what will happen? It will only ruin, we will ruin ourselves. And the fact of the matter is, some people spend their lives like this and simply pass on. They simply pass on. Nothing much happens in their life. So that is the intuitive appreciation one needs to have from these verses, because the verse itself may appear to be very simple. But the profound meaning of it, the depth at which one needs to understand, is what is important. So as I would like to reiterate again what I started by saying, that as frequently as possible, one needs to affirm this to oneself and come to a deep realization at the core of one's being. And please don't make it a kind of an obsession or a self-hypnotic process. It is through the faculty of discernment, through the faculty of discrimination or viveka, one has to come to this deep affirmation and realization. And in the process, whether it is the body or the mind, we have to make it very sensitive. We have to ensure that it functions in that manner and open a channel for communicating with the body and the mind. Because after all, your one's closest friend is one's own body and mind. Who is the person closest to you or me? It is the me itself. It is the Atma. That's what the Brihadaranyaka Upanishad very elaborately says. You are attached to your spouse not because of the spouse, but because of yourself. You are attached to your children not because of the children, but because you are attached to the self. Navare patyuh kamaya patih priyo bhavati. Atmanah kamaya patih priyo bhavati. See, it's not for the desire of the wife or the husband that one is looking at it from that way. Because you are dear to yourself, the other person is becoming dear. So that, unless you open that channel of communication with those people who are, those entities like the body and the mind, which are the closest to you, you will not be able to move forward from a spiritual perspective. You need to have a very close link and a communication with one's own body and one's own mind, and make them as sensitive as possible so that they become very good instruments for service. And repeatedly it has been said in the scriptures that the body and the mind are very good slaves but very bad masters. Body and mind are very good slaves but are very bad masters. If you allow them to dominate over you, they will destroy you. If you make them your master, we are lost. We have to make them our slaves. Slaves in the sense that they abide and do what we want to do, we want them to do, and act as we say. That's all. Nothing beyond that. So that is the nature of things which we need to understand. There is some chat. Ramchandran ji says, sensitive and alert all the time, our body is somehow possible, mind is not most difficult animal. Yeah, that is true. That is why you have to do a better job. The first attack the difficult enemy. First try to operate in such a manner that you are able to see the fallacy of it. See the fallacy of it and operate on that at that level. Otherwise, this will it will continue to dominate us. Okay. Any further? It's already 5:07. If we have any other questions, we can discuss them. Participants, please. Any other question, Sarangi ji? Dr. Sana, Suman Goenka ji, if you have any further point, Meena Nirula ji, if you have any point, we can discuss. I hope the drift of these two verses is very clear. And I would like you to, at the cost of repetition, I am mentioning that please try to, remember these points of what I said as a constant affirmation and realization at one's own core, at the core of one's being, that I am not the body and the mind. That is where the Nirvana Shatkam comes. Mano Buddhya Hankara Chittani Naham Chidananda Rupa Shivoham Shivoham. That's where he says, I'm not the mind, I'm not the Buddhi, I'm not the Ahankara, I'm not the Chitta. He's completely dissociating himself from the Antahkarana itself. Forget about the body and the lower mind and other things. And he comes to that also in the course of the Nirvana Shatkam. He defies and denies everything. He says, I have no father, no mother, no guru, nothing. I am none of these things. Nothing really matters. And I am not any of these things. I am the Chidananda Rupa Shivoham Shivoham. That's the affirmation. At the core of
that's what I felt, sir. That's yes, what sir? I wanted to say, sir.
Yeah. Okay. Thank you. Thank you, Manjulaji. Sorry for snatching away your words.
No, not like that. I really wanted to say that because same thing it is.
Yeah. Yes. So that's the idea. That's the idea behind it. So that the Nirvana Shatkam is a reaffirmation of one's own true self. That's what is required. Okay.
And it says, I am Ishvara. I am the bliss.
Yeah, Shiva. I am that supreme, sacred and auspicious state of being, supreme being.
Yes.
That's what it is. Okay.
And you have given the definition for Shiva, Jivatma, everything. Now we know the difference, what it is.
Yeah. You talked about Brahman, Ishvara and Jiva.
Yeah.
Sir.
Some chat is there. Gulu Advani ji, thank you. Very clearly explained session as always. Thank you, Gulu ji. Any further discussion from the participants? I would be happy to take that. Yeah.
Sir, how do I treat myself that I'm not?
Meena Nirula ji, can you are not very audible. Can you repeat?
But how do I tell myself that I'm not thinking from my body, I'm not working with my mind, my emotions, my perceptions, my experiences? How do they all fall into?
Madam, if you are asking for a method or a process, it is very difficult. It's not a method or a process. It is an intuitive perception at a deeper level, which comes through silence. So if we are able to make our body and mind as silent as possible, then it is possible to touch that source of one's own true being. The moment you ask a question, how do I do that, how do I do that, that means you are only operating within the field of the known.
That's it.
It is like trying to calm down the waves by putting our hand, beating our hands. No, it will not help. So it has to come through that silence. So that silence is what is to be, I don't really say practiced. It should, if the body knows how to be silent and if the mind knows how to be silent, and yet at the same time very alert and aware, as Jiddu Krishnamurti often used to say, if you are in that state of great alertness and awareness without the interference of the thought, then you may come upon that sacred silence, which is one's own true nature. So it has to be, it's not an affirmation by saying that I am the Atman, I am the Atman, I am not this body. It's not saying it aloud and repeating it. It is realizing it at one's own, at the core of one's own being, by giving adequate time to it to become silent. Now, we don't give that time at all. One after the other, we keep doing something or the other and then chasing something or the other, and then repeatedly we are falling into this because this is the something which is known to us.
Yeah.
So that give some space, give some time to it. Allow that silence to pervade one's own being. Then we will be able to come to that easily. Otherwise, it is very difficult. Ramchandranji, you were saying something? Ramchandranji, can you unmute yourself if you want to say something?
Sarji.
Your voice is breaking, sir.
Information. And there is no process.
No, there is no process as such. As I said, it is a more a case of your voice was breaking. Can you are you saying something?
No, you're just okay. Asking the deep affirmation to the core of the mind. Can it be done in deep meditation?
No, meditation.
Awareness.
Sir, again, meditation is a very wrongly understood subject and word. See, if you want me to explain that to you, I would take the words of Jiddu Krishnamurti. Jiddu Krishnamurti used to often say that meditation is that state when there is no meditator. When there is no meditator, then true meditation goes on. But the meditator always interferes in the process and thinks that I want to meditate and I am meditating and I am keeping quiet, I am becoming silent, and all that is only a kind of a confused mind operating. True meditation happens when there is no meditator. When there is no interference from this entity or identity which I call as myself. The meditator is the greatest hindrance for meditation. So that is what one needs to realize. See, just as one realizes that one is there, at the core of our being, do we not understand and realize that I am there?
Yes, we do.
I am there, isn't it? in that manner one needs to feel or one needs to come into a realization that I am not the body and I am not this thought which is operating through me, which is the mind which is operating. So it comes through that silence. It comes into manifestation and pervades our being when there is that silence operating. Without that silence, you can't come to it at all.
True.
You can't come to it. Yato vacho nivartante aprapya manasasaha. Where the words recoil and the mind cannot grasp or reach that, it is that state of consciousness which we are talking about. One needs to come to it. Yeah. One cannot force oneself to come to that. One needs to know what silence is to come to that. Otherwise, it won't happen. Okay, sir?
Yeah, Krishnapani ji, namaste.
Yes, Dr. Sana, tell me.
Yeah. You rightly said you need to see that your body and mind is not allowed to dominate. Okay?
Yes, yes.
But those who are following spiritual path, most of them are in towns and cities. Of course, there are few from villages also. But life is becoming increasingly difficult with cities becoming smart cities. They are becoming so smart cities, it has become increasingly difficult for us to keep away from the mind and body. Maybe there is a need to have 24/7 meditative mood. And also now the government is planning to allow shops to be open 24/7.
sir, the point is,
and the government is creating problem now.
No, the point is the government is looking at from an economic point of view, but what I am trying to say is it is not becoming extremely difficult. We are making it extremely difficult for ourselves.
Yes, that is true.
No, but there is no compulsion from outside which can force you to do anything, sir.
But if you are see, called, the temptation, if, it's something like Vishwamitra, some of these saintly people
sir, who are... Sir, it doesn't matter. Dr. Sana, it doesn't matter that you fail a million times. But don't lose track of your path totally. You may fall on the path 10 times.
I am in a village domain, so it has become off late very easy for me to go into good. That state of
good
connected to Atman and correct. Keep mind and body little away. But when I come to say today, I had come to smart city, now Bangalore city.
No, the smart city will so make us all stupid.
Stupid, that's what
the smart city is. The city is smart, the phone is smart, but the user and the dweller are fools and stupid.
No, very difficult to resist this temptation, I tell you.
Very difficult. Nobody said it is easy, sir. The point of the matter is, again, I'm saying that even if you fall, it doesn't matter. But as I said, how fast can and how soon can you regain yourself and then stand up again and move in the right direction? Don't fall into an abyss. Don't fall into a khadda. If you're falling on the path, it is okay. You can get up, brush yourself, dust yourself free, and then start walking again. But don't fall in such a way that it becomes difficult to stand up again. That is one's own sadhana. It is one's own sadhana. If one is tempted by a million things, you get tempted. Nobody can really help you. Unless you help yourself, no external agency can truly help you, or me, anybody for that matter.
No, sir, a total awareness of the self is what we have been aware of now.
That, sir, madam, look at the whole thing. Look at the whole thing. Look how the mind operates. Look how the body behaves. Look how the thoughts behave. look what kind of things emerge from our own thoughts and mind and feelings and emotions and desires. Look at the whole thing. Become attentive and aware to the whole thing that is going on. Don't exclude anything. Look at the whole thing.
Yeah, from the whole process.
Yeah, we isolate it, we make it exclusive, and we are very selective. The mind is a very cunning instrument. It is very selective.
Yes, correct.
It is exclusive. It is isolating. It is self-enclosing. It is self-limiting. Look at the whole thing.
Yeah.
Don't exclude anything. Look at the whole thing. Then you will be able to come to something, an unknown dimension may come into being.
True.
Not through our expectations. If it is there, you come to it. It's as simple as that.
Yes.
So that, again, I'm saying that deep affirmation and deep realization has to be at the core of our being, just as we are aware of the fact that I am there and I am alive. In that sense, it should become real. In that sense, it should become sensitive. The body should be very sensitive. The mind should be very sharp and very sensitive.
Then
you can, as I said, then you can communicate with them. You can talk to your own body. You can talk to your own mind. You can communicate, not necessarily talk in the sense verbal. I'm not talking about verbal communication only. There is a non-verbal communication.
Yeah.
So that channel of communication has to be opened. Otherwise, it'll go on like this. It'll go on and on and on like this in an endless cycle. Okay, madam. So
thank
it's already 5:23. Yes, please.
Can I read when Sukta, sir? Will you tell me whether it can go for Atman? Anantam Kavim Samudrentham Vishwashambhuvam Padmakosha Pratikasham Hrudayancha Api Adhomukham.
That is from the Purusha Sukta or Mantra Pushpa.
It is from Vishwa Purusha Narayana Sukta.
Yeah, that's that same thing. That same thing. You will find that in the Mantra Pushpam. You will find that in the Purusha Sukta. You will find the same thing. But that will require a detailed elaboration about the meaning of it, which we can do at a later stage when we have more time. We can do that.
Okay.
Thank you so much.
Thank you very much.
Beenaji, you can, I think, close the
thank session. You so much, Krishnapaniji. Thank you. I think we were quite a few of us in spite of changing the time. So that's good.
Yeah.
This meeting is recorded. So whoever actually hasn't got it, we can send them the recording. So that's good. And can I request Meena to do the Loka Samastha, please? And we're going to meet, by the way, everybody, we are going to meet Krishnapaniji on Friday, that is the 8th. At 10:30 in the morning to do Bhagavad Gita, and then again on the 10th for Sunday for Atma Bodha at the usual time, 10:00 in the morning. Thank you.
Meena Nirudhaji.
Swasti prajapya paripalayantam nyayena margena mahesha gobrahmane vyashubhastu nityam समस्त सुखिनो भवन्तु समस्त लोकाः सुखिनो भवन्तु समस्त लोकाः सुखिनो भवन्तु ॐ शान्ति शान्ति हरिः ॐ श्री गुरुभ्यो नमः हरिः ओम् श्रीकृष्णार्पणमस्तु
थैंक यू मीना जी Okay. All right. We'll see you again on Thursday for the school program.
Thank you, Krishna.
Thank you. Thank you so much.
Thank you, Sarji.